great pleasure in welcoming David Harvey here to give this special guest lecture. I guess it's about the easiest introductory job in world geography to introduce David Harvey, so I shan't say a great deal about him. What I will do is just explain how come he's here at all. The idea of this special session grew out of an idea of the organizing committee of this conference about a year and a half ago, when we, I think it was volunteered to have the IBG here. We thought that if we were to do that, we wanted the conference to be something which included a distinctive Durham flavor. And we've sought in the organizing of the program the advice we've given to the study groups to see that some of the themes in the research that's carried out in this department were expressed. We managed to get the Islamic world and the population geography together into one session, but there are other sessions on recession, on the third world, on women in the developing world, on theoretical geomorphology and the Mediterranean, the sorts of themes which we're used to dealing with in this department. We also wanted to mark the radical theoretical work which has been carried out here, and we could think of no better person to invite to do that for us than David. He very kindly agreed to come, although he's only just settling himself down into Paris. He's torn himself away from his apartment on the left bank for a few days to be with us, and we're very grateful to him for that. What we propose is that he will talk on his topic, which is the history and the present condition of geography. He's going to present a historical materialist manifesto in the course of about 40 minutes. And we propose that after that 40 minutes, there will be some 15 minutes or so in which we'd invite not so much questions directly to David, but rather comments, coherently phrased and elaborated statements in reaction to his views, to which he will comment at the end, rather than degenerating into a few dialogues. If people do feel that David's either got it all right or all wrong, you'll have your chance to tell him so at about 6:10. David.
There are three ideas that I want to present in this paper. The first idea is that we have to understand the history of geography in its social, historical context. That is, there is no such thing as the history of geographical knowledge without considering the history of the specific societies within which that geography is embedded. The second theme is, coming out of that, that statements about the future of geography, or statements about the transformation of our discipline, cannot be seen independent of ideas about the transformation of our society. That therefore, statements about the future of geography are, in some way or other, statements about the future of society. And the third point I want to make coming out of that is to say that there's a very specific view of the transformation of society, which I and some others hold, which leads to a certain view as to what geography should be about in the future. So let me take those three points in order. The first point, then, is the idea that geographical knowledge is connected to the kind of society which exists. That is, geography and the mode of production are very much connected. What this suggests is that there are several different geographical knowledges, and that those geographical knowledges are connected to the characteristic forms of production and reproduction which society engages in. Now, that suggests immediately then that there are also forms of geography which are connected with Islam, China, etc., 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 which are very specific to those kinds of societies. What I'm particularly interested in, however, is the rise of the bourgeois form of geography with the rise of capitalism. And what has been really surprising to me about the history of our discipline is that nobody's written that fantastic, wonderful book yet called The Geographical Spirit and the Rise of Capitalism. Because the rise of capitalism entailed the construction and reconstruction of a new form of geographical knowledge. the reconstruction of knowledges which had gone before, drawn from Islam, Greece, China, etc., etc., and also the use of those knowledges in a new context to try to create a new form of geography. Now, when you look at the geographical practices in the bourgeois era, there are six practices that I would draw attention to. The first practice is concern for accuracy of navigation, concern for the accurate definition of property rights and territorial rights and state rights, led to a tremendous interest in accuracy of mapping. That accuracy of mapping was one of the ways in which private property rights were established over the whole realm of the globe in areas where there had never been private property rights before. It was also a means of establishing territorial rights in a way that had not been established before in many parts of the world. That idea has both a positive and negative aspects, and these six aspects of practices I wish to present to you in both a positive and negative light. The negative aspects of that was that, of course, the definition of exclusivities of territories allowed for the definition of exclusive rights of exploitation, not only of land, but also of labor within those territories. The exclusive appropriation of surplus product within those territories of one class by another class. On the other hand, the accurate mapping of the world allowed considerable capacity for communication and also allows for the rational organization of space according to certain kind of principles. And if we wish to think about principles associated with human welfare, I think it is possible to think of that practice in those terms. The second practice which I would turn to is the practice of looking around the world for use values in nature, that is, a natural resource inventory, which is going to be used then as part of a process of exploitation of nature in relation to, again, a dominant capitalist mode of production. The exploitation of nature goes hand in hand with the exploitation of human beings, and that leads to the third practice, which is really the assessment of human resources on the basis of the kinds of labor power which, or labor qualities which are available in different parts of the world at different places in different times. Now, both of those resource things, both natural and human resources, both of those, I think, have to be seen as part of a process of domination and reorganization of social life under capitalism. At the same time, accurate representation of those resources provides the possibility to think in terms of harmonious organization of society and nature, and also the possibility of harmonious organization of societies in relationship to societies. This leads on, however, to the fourth aspect, which is the geopolitical organization of the Earth's surface, the division of territories in between competing powers at the end of the 19th century, which led to another kind of geographical practice, which had a lot to do with the rational organization of space from the standpoint of political power and political domination. This, of course, was the work of Haushofer, Mackinder before him, and Ratzel as well. So that geopolitical notion also starts to become very important in geographical practice. The geopolitical notion that then starts to become inverted in third world liberation struggles in terms of trying to find a geopolitical way to create an island of freedom in a system of general domination. The fifth component really is a more modern one, which is concerned with the rational organization and use of natural and human resources. And this leads us to the idea of the role of geographical thinking in planning, the role of geographical thinking in terms of optimizing locations and things of that kind, leads us to the idea, which has been very important since 1945, of the role of the geographer being tightly connected with coming up with rational organization of the Earth's surface. Again, the dominant notion of rationality is a capitalist notion of rationality, that is, whatever is profitable, whatever is can be organized in terms of social control of labor power and control of natural resources. But nevertheless, there is there are alternative definitions of rationality, which are frequently proposed by utopians and others, which I think also give the possibility to think about the reorganization of society in ways other than the society we currently have. Sixthly, geographical thought in the bourgeois era has had a very strong ideological component, a very strong ideological function. Its ideological function is largely connected, partly to its claim to be a science in which it treats nature and human beings as objects capable of manipulation to the ends of a certain sort, but partly also in terms of its claim to art, in terms of representations of the world, in which racism, sexism, classism, and all the other isms you can think of are very well represented in geographical texts. By the same token, the ideological function has also allowed geographers to think about the construction of alternative geographies, that is, to begin to think of utopian landscapes as the possibility for the future. Now, those geographical practices have been very important in the bourgeois era. And what we have tried to do as an academic discipline is to try to forge some kind of coherent identity out of those geographical practices in a context of a rising division of labor within academia itself and a rising professionalization of academic functions. And the way we have done this has, I think, to be said, not been that successful. And this for a number of reasons. First off, geographers have the wonderful habit of posing very, very important and profound questions and trivializing the answers. We have this habit of talking about grand themes about relation to nature, about regions, development, so on, and we have the habit of turning it into some Mickey Mouse little enterprise of, you know, just a few little maps or something of that sort. We ask the big questions, trivialize the answers. At the same time, we lacked a methodology, a powerful methodology that was really going to be able to take the kind of geographical practices which exist and synthesize them into an academic discipline. And I would argue that that methodology is historical materialism, and that the failure of geographers to grapple with historical materialism early on in our discipline was, in fact, one of our most serious failings. In the face of these difficulties, what geographers have done is to seek for an increasing analytic professionalization of our parts. That is, geography has fragmented into little bits and pieces. And the more it is fragmented into little bits and pieces, the more it has organized those bits and pieces along tight analytic lines, so geography as a discipline has lost its synthetic identity. What has happened is that geomorphologists can just as easily run off into geology. Location theorists can run off into economics, if the economists will have them. And in other words, the parts get dispersed into all of the other disciplines. We therefore lack a coherent center to our discipline because the parts became increasingly professionalized. At the same time, we gave up something which was terribly important, which is the popular organization of geographical knowledge in relationship to popular culture. That is, we started to look down upon being professionals. We were very nervous about, you know, what the National Geographic did and all those kinds of things, and we started to look down upon that and kept ourselves apart from popular culture, popular education, into those geographical practices which I think were fundamental to our understanding of the world. But what this then means to me is that we've been caught as a discipline between lack of academic identity and profundity on the one hand and a weak popular base on the other. And try going to any dean in an American university and making a claim for geography when you have no academic profundity and you have no popular base and you won't get very far. So this has then, I think, led us to the current dilemma. In terms of that current dilemma, with the analytic evolution of the parts, particularly towards a dominant form of positivism, there arose the critique in the late 1960s, a radical critique of where geography was going. One of the healthiest things that I think has happened in the history of geography, and I think will be shown to be such. The failing credibility of the positivist stance. And indeed, the reason why the positivist stance itself arose have, I think, to be seen politically. One of the arguments I would want to make very strongly is that the academic, who began to emerge as a powerful force in society in the late 19th century, in the progressive era in the United States in particular, that the academic began to make claims to be above class struggle, that is, to be neither on the side of capital nor on the side of labor, to be above it all. In geography, one of the best representatives of that is Isaiah Bowman, who started off by, in a way, saying that he could define national interest in terms of geography. He ended his life turning it the other way around and defining a geography in the national interest, because that's the way in which my department could get established in Johns Hopkins. This rise of the academic into that kind of position of political importance in affairs was seriously challenged, and most seriously challenged of all in the 1950s, in the period of McCarthyism. And I will argue that one of the biggest reasons for the shift towards positivism, it was a bit like Bacon going to empiricism to get religion off his back. The social scientists went to positivism to get politics off their back. That is, positivism created a shield between them and the political vendettas which existed particularly strongly during the Cold War. The classic case of persecution of Owen Latimore in the United States is a case in point. After the persecution of Owen Latimore during the McCarthy era, there was no way in which you could continue to be a political geographer except by working for the State Department. And even then, it was dangerous, as Owen Latimore found out. So what better way to deal with that political situation than to hide behind the positivist shield? The rise of positivism has to be seen then as something political in the political history of academia. And in the same way, the fall of positivism has similarly to be interpreted as something political, a political revolt against hiding behind that positivist shield, the desire on the part of that class of people, academics and the like, to come out from behind that positivist shield and to exercise some kind of responsibility towards the facts of geography as we were uncovering them. Now, the critique of ideology, of Marxist ideology in the 1960s, led to a general outburst of radical critiques of all kinds. Marxism, anarchism, humanism, geographical expeditions, advocacy, etc., a whole group of epiphenomena, really, of trends within academia emerged. There was tremendous distinctions between them, but at the same time, they had a common core of concern. And the common core of concern was to get away from what was really the positivist silence about political questions, to get behind the positivist shield, and to try to prize out from behind that positivist shield a process of becoming. That is, all of those arguments had a central idea in common, which was the idea of becoming, that we are part and parcel of a process of transformation of society. We cannot see ourselves as separate from that process. We have to see ourselves as integral to that process. And out of this came, I think, a new agenda for geography, which was to see the construction of geographical knowledge, the construction of new geographical knowledges, as part and parcel of a process of construction of a new kind of society. And that then brings us, if you like, to the current dilemma, that without a great deal of popular base, without a great deal of intellectual profundity, and with in the midst of this kind of toing and froing between positivism and the critical reaction, that somehow in there we have to find our way towards the creation of a revitalized geography, a revitalized, a new intellectual discipline that can play a vital, creative, and progressive role in shaping the social transformations that beset us. And I would argue that how to negotiate that passage is our dilemma of this time. So what do we make then of the present condition of geography? Geography and geographical knowledge is far too important to be left to geographers. But by the same token, it's far too important to be left to generals, politicians, and corporate chiefs. So the question then is how to reconstruct geographical knowledge in some way that is outside of the military, political, and corporate requirements which dominate and are increasingly dominating academia. Because to sell ourselves and the geography we make to the corporation is, in fact, to engage in the production of a geographical landscape of their making. That is, a geographical landscape of seething social inequality and seething geopolitical tensions. And in this regard, right now, part of the difficulty which we face is precisely that that is where our money is coming from, that is where our funds come from, that is who is in a position to dominate us simply through the power of money. The selling of ourselves to government is another problem, a more difficult problem. The government, like the academics of the progressive era, often claims that it is above the interests of capital and labor. That is an argument which is hard to accept. The government itself is very clearly affected by the kinds of funding it receives from the kinds of sources it gets it. And in the same way, it too is caught up in this movement of money and the power of money to dominate all life. Because what we're witnessing very much right now is what Marx long ago talked about when he said, money disrupts the community, but ultimately money becomes the community. And if you ask, what is it that pins us all together right now, it's money. The alternative, I think, to that is to the creation of an alternative kind of geography, a people's geography, one which is not beholden to any special interests, which is not particularly concerned to serve corporate or government interests, but which is truly dedicated to the idea of trying to create a geography as part of a process of social transformation towards human liberation. That geography, I would submit, must open channels of communication, must undermine parochialist worldviews, confront or subvert the power of dominant classes or the state. It must penetrate the barriers to common understandings by identifying the material base to common interests. Where such a material base does not exist, it must frankly recognize and articulate conflict of equal and competing rights that flows therefrom. To the degree that conflicting rights are resolved through tests of strength between contending parties, so the intellectual force within our discipline is a powerful weapon and must be consciously deployed as such. What I'm arguing for here is that geography not be considered as a neutral discipline. It is not neutral, never can be neutral, never should even pretend to be neutral. On the other hand, we can aspire to scientific integrity and honesty and scientific rigor. And I would like to make a very clear differentiation between the two. It is possible to be partisan at the same time as to be scientifically rigorous and intellectually honest. And the way we do that is to start to construct an understanding of the world, geographical understandings of the world, from the standpoint of the peoples themselves. That is, that the view from Wall Street looking outwards is an authentic view of the world. And do not deny its existence. It is important to reconstruct it. The view from China looking outwards, to use a Lattimore title, which is one of my favorites, can also be reconstructed. The two views of the world are very different. There are many different windows to look upon the world, but from each one we can strive for some kind of integrity and honesty with what we see from that window. That is what I mean by the difference between neutrality and scientific rigor and integrity. What this then suggests is that we have to start to put together, find a common language in which we can put these myriad views of the world together towards some common core of understanding. And that says that the intellectual task of geographers, our intellectual task is the construction of a common language, of common frames of reference and theoretical understandings within which conflicting rights and claims can properly be represented. Positivism undermines its own virtues of objective materialism by spurious claims to neutrality. Historical materialism, though appropriate, is too frequently held captive within the rigidities of some political orthodoxy that renders windows on the world opaque and substitutes subjectively conceived political fantasy for hard-nosed materialism. Under such conditions, the construction of a common discourse for describing and theorizing becomes a very tough task, and I would submit that that is the intellectual task that is on our agenda. Now, it so happens, however, that the intellectual baggage that we have accumulated these last few years has puts us in a rather good position to attack that task, and puts us in a position where our contributions are potentially crucial. For example, the insertion of the concept of space into social theory creates mayhem with the central propositions of that social theory. Economists talking about perfect competition find spatial monopoly. Macroeconomists find as many economies as there are central banks and as many exchange rates between them as you look in the Wall Street Journal and just look at the fluctuations and you say, how can you make sense of that? Marxists looking to class relations find neighborhoods, communities, and all the rest of it. Marx, Marshall, Weber, Durkheim, they all had this in common. Grand social theorists though they were, they prioritized time over space. And they treated space and geography as a site or unproblematic context for historical action. It turns out that when you try to introduce space into any general social theory, the basic categories of that social theory have to change. And what we find is that we are either forced to abandon the theory altogether and to go to ad hoc adjustments, or else we're forced to resort to some kind of pure geometric language in which the social aspects disappear entirely. What this means is that if we do not construct a social theory into which we integrate spatial concepts much more thoroughly, we will have lost what seems to me one of the big intellectual opportunities which we have, which is to bring a much better geographical perspective into social theory, to make that social theory much more realistic, and then thereby find ourselves capable of expressing the conflicting rights and claims of many different peoples as they exist throughout the world. The junction between geography and social theory, then, is one of the crucial flashpoints for the crystallization of new conceptions of the world and new possibilities for active intervention. The political implications of a resolution of that are, I think, legion and highly charged. And I want to consider, as an example, the clash between anarchist and Marxist perspectives, both politically and within the history of geography. Reclus and Kropotkin both, geographers, anarchists, were impressed by the remarkable diversity of human life as they observed it on the Earth's surface and sought to preserve that diversity through a project that linked the peoples of the Earth into some vast federation of autonomous, self-governing communities. This entailed a highly decentralized and a profoundly geographical vision of how an alternative society should look. And it has helped fuel a political tradition concerned with worker self-management, community control, ecological sensitivity, respect for the individual. And I would argue that it is no accident that the radical urge in 19th century geography was expressed through anarchism rather than through Marxism. The sensitivity to issues of place, ecology, milieu, and geographical particularities still makes the anarchist vision appealing. Yet it is seriously flawed by the absence of any powerful understanding of the true dynamics of capitalism. Reclus, in his last work, recognized that the intriguing geographical variety for which he had such respect was even then being swept away, crushed under the homogenizing heel of the circulation and accumulation of capital. The universality of the circulation of capital and the experience that creates, that demands a global political response, born out of more powerful universal understandings of the dynamics of capitalism than Reclus ever constructed. His political vision and his intellectual contribution are undermined by this crucial absence, and I would argue that continues to be true of much of the anarchist tradition. Marx, for his part, occupies the pinnacle of social theoretic power at the expense of excluding geographical variation as an unnecessary complication. He prioritizes time over space, and while he frequently, in his, he's a sensitive enough guy to pull in all of the bits and pieces about town and country and uneven geographical development into his themes, but basically, he tried to write a theory of historical development which excluded the geography of capitalism as being relevant to his understandings. His political vision and theoretical contribution, I would argue, founder on his failure to build a systematic and distinctively geographical dimension into his thought. This was the error that Lenin and the theorists of imperialism sought to rectify. They opened up the possibility of an alternative rhetoric within the Marxist tradition in which centers exploit peripheries, the first world subjugates the third, the capitalist powers compete for domination of protected space, markets, labor power, raw materials, and the like. People in one place exploit and struggle against those in another place. Now, this has always bothered me. I've never really understood what the theoretical basis of Marxist-Leninism was, because here is Marx talking about the exploitation of one class by another class being the moving force of history, whereas there's a whole history of thinking about imperialism since Lenin, which talks about the exploitation of one people in one place by those in another place as being the problem. How to integrate the two then becomes the most serious question, and Marxists have failed to do it, leaving themselves with a tremendous savage dispute over things like the right to national self-determination, the national question, the prospects for socialism in one country, and the significance of geographical decentralization in political practice. Now, there is more to the split between Marxists and anarchists than their respective approaches to geographical questions. But the Marxists, while proclaiming in principle the significance of geographical uneven development, have had a hard time integrating space or evolving a sensitivity to place and milieu within otherwise powerful social theories. The anarchist literature abounds with such sensitivity, but founders on lack of theoretical and political coherence, all of which provokes the intriguing, though somewhat idle thought, what would our political and intellectual world be like if Marx had been a better geographer and Reclus had been a better social theorist? That rhetorical question underlines the contemporary political importance of a theoretical project dedicated to the unification of geographical sensitivities and understandings with the power of general social theories formulated in the tradition of historical materialism. Such a theoretical project is more than just a tough academic exercise. It is fundamental to our thinking of the prospects for the transition to socialism. What this suggests is a requirement for a historical materialist manifesto, which becomes a historical geographical materialist manifesto. The task before us can, I think, be more clearly defined. First, build a popular geography, free from prejudice, but reflective of real conflicts and contradictions, capable also of opening new channels for communication and common understanding. Second, create an applied people's geography, unbeholden to narrow or powerful special interests, but broadly democratic in its conception. Three, accept a dual methodological commitment to scientific integrity and non-neutrality. Four, integrate geographical sensitivities into general social theories emanating from the historical materialist tradition. Five, define a political project that sees the transition from capitalism to socialism in historico-geographical terms. We have the power, through our collective efforts as geographers, to help make our own history and our own geography. That we cannot do so under historical and geographical circumstances of our own choosing is self-evident. In part, our role is to explore the limits imposed by the dead weight of an actually existing geography and an already achieved history. But we must define also a radical guiding vision, one that explores the realms of freedom beyond material necessity, that opens the way to the creation of new forms of society in which common people have the power to create their own geography and history in the image of liberty and mutual respect of opposed interests. The only other course, I would submit, is to sustain a present geography on its present course, a present geography founded on class oppression, state domination, unnecessary material deprivation, war, and human denial. I've had my 40 minutes.
Actually, we were looking for someone to give a third-year lecture on contemporary human geography next week. Can you just hang on for a few days? No, we've stuck to the timetable as scheduled. What I would like to do is to invite people from the floor who feel that they will be able to limit themselves to 2 minutes, and I will have the watch with a second hand on them, who would like to make comments in response to David's type of manifesto. It will help us enormously in trying to flog this video to Channel 4 if you will state who you are and what interests you represent when you try to catch my eye. So can I have an idea of those who might wish to make the first remarks? Ron, please.
Johnson, I don't know my interest groups apart from swimming and tan.
I'm not sure that's legitimate.
I would wish to question David or to comment upon is his representation of bourgeois geography, which, though I wouldn't disagree with it as a representation of American bourgeois geography, didn't necessarily seem to me to be a representation of bourgeois geography per se. His description of American geography as being lacking intellectual profundity and a popular base doesn't carry across to this country, at least with regard to the popular base. His description of the retreat into positivism doesn't square to my understanding, which I have to admit is limited, of what happened in what I presume he would describe as bourgeois countries in other parts of Europe at the same time. And I wonder whether it's not the retreat into empiricism and the Anglo-American form of that retreat is just one particular manifestation of it, rather than being the retreat into, or the backing away into positivism, which he seems to characterise all of bourgeois geography. I think I'm probably broadening it rather than arguing against it.
I think if you really want to come back very specifically, yes,
I think what we'll do is to take the set of comments as such, unless there's anything which David specifically wants to come back on, he'll respond in 5 minutes at the end. Is there anyone else who feels they have anything which would enlighten us? Can I take David Slater at the back there first, then there. David. Can you speak up?
Yeah, a couple of very brief comments. One thing which I find very quite a remarkable sort of the way David Harvey talks about historical materialism is the assumption that there's basically only one current, in the sense that one goes back to Capital and the theories of surplus value, and one analyzes essentially the accumulation and valorization of capital. There's another tradition which goes back to Gramsci, and which relates much more to the question of ideology and social movements. And I think if you remain with the first tradition, which is Capital and the theories of surplus value, it becomes very difficult to analyze all the new social movements which have emerged over the last 10 or 15 years. And then I think what happens is you switch from that one reading of historical materialism to a kind of populist anarchist position, which has the weakness that it doesn't contain any theoretical concepts to analyze contemporary reality. So a question there is, if we're going beyond historical materialism, as David Harvey treats it, the limits to capital, what other theoretical concepts are we going to use, and for what purpose? Second question, I'm not really sure how we are to define geography, or such things as geographical variations, and spatial concepts if we go out of historical materialism. Perhaps they could say more about that. And thirdly, I'm not really sure what he means by the concept of the people or popular, because there are various definitions of the popular. There's a right-wing definition, there's a left-wing definition. The right-wing definition is, for example, one leader in Peru in the 1930s said, I'm going to approach the people with a whip in the right hand and a loaf of bread in the left. That's a right-wing definition of populism. So I think one has to develop other definitions of populism. And I find that very much missing, not only from the presentation, but also from the written paper, which I was simply
Elkins, University of Sussex. I've never been asked to declare my interest before, but I suppose it's bourgeois, liberal, and I hope intellectual. I've got really a rather naive comment, which I don't think is really a fundamental disagreement, but I've just been living, had two spells of living in a country which claims to be socialist, and I was very much taken by Professor Harvey's first six or eight, whatever it was, points about exact measurement, about the location of resources for exploitation, about the location of people for exploitation. Not long ago, I was standing in the middle of the brown coal field south of Leipzig, seeing the villages being quarried away, their inhabitants dispersed, whether they liked it or not. The holes, no doubt, being exactly measured. There can be nothing more exactly measured than the Berlin Wall. The only point that I want to make, and I don't think this is a disagreement, because I heard some reference from David Harvey in relation to state capitalism, is that his points 1 to 8, it would seem, as a matter of naive observation, do not automatically disappear when labeled with socialism. Maybe there is one socialism and another socialism.
Neil Smith, Columbia University, New York. I've got really 2 points to make, I think. And the first is that I think the reading of Marx is maybe a little more naive than we're used to from David Harvey. That the understanding of Marx as emphasizing time over space is perhaps correct in the context of the 19th century. When you look at what's actually happened to the development of capitalism in the last 100 years, then we can see that Marx's emphasis on the development of markets, what Marx saw as the annihilation of space by time, has not come true. What Marx seemed to expect was that in some sense the third world would be used as a means of selling goods from the developed core and from the increasingly developed third world. What's actually happened is quite the opposite. The third world has been used much more as a resource of cheap labor. This, in fact, has brought about a process, I would argue, of a differentiation, a much sharper differentiation of world capitalism in a spatial sense than was evident in Marx's time. So to critique Marx with the anarchist whip, I would say, is rather anachronistic. The second point concerns David Harvey's consideration of a people's geography. I think here that there's a problem of falling into a trap that I think we have all critiqued the positivist tradition for doing, and it's a trap of relativism. In the end, the question is, well, which people? And David Harvey says that there are no special interest groups in the people's geography that he's calling for. In fact, for Marx, there's a very clear special interest group, and that special interest group was the working class. And it was not an accident, and nor was it an intellectual product that was a special interest group that Marx focused on. For in the end, Marx focused on the working class as not only those who experienced the exploitation of capitalism, but as those who were the only ones who in the end were capable of doing anything about the exploitation and the problems that capitalism wrought. The point, in the end, is that the kind of focus that Harvey is looking for, I think, on a geographical manifesto is only possible through a much sharper lens, not of a people's geography, but of a geography from the view of the working class.
We have other points. Can I take them in that order, please? One there and then there.
White Lake, Lancaster University. The manifesto is a programme for action. I fail to see how a group of self-confessed bourgeois geographers are going to review their own situation and take a course of action which is fundamentally out of character and out of line with their previous actions. If bourgeois geography grew in such basic linkage with the nature of the capitalist society, then the capitalist society itself is surely going to have to change and to impose change in its terms, whatever replaces the capitalist society, on a group of largely stodgy, immobile bourgeois geographers who are in no way going to accept any manifesto of this kind, even if it were diluted considerably from what you've stated so far. How do you see this change coming about?
Stuffy, immobile, and now steaming, in fact. Ventilation stop.
Graham Gudgeon, University of Cambridge. Like Ron Johnston, I didn't greatly recognise David Harvey's description of geography, or at least the British geography. Although there's an element of truth in what he says, I think essentially he's setting up a straw man. I was being corrected on my left. I stopped to hear what the correction was. I said straw man, I should have said straw person, apparently. If I may continue, I just thought British geography was more accurately be described as pluralist, that whereas some work suits governments and corporations quite nicely, other work suits them not at all, and further work suits perhaps nobody very much. Nobody's interest very much anyway. I didn't fully understand, I think, what the new geography was that was being proposed here. And I had a suspicion that perhaps it would be a late later, that it would get rid of this pluralism. It would damp down pluralism to some extent. And yet, surely we'd all accept that pluralism in most institutions, and in British academic life, as in most other institutions in present-day Britain, is essential to the form of democracy we have, or to the democracy we have.
John Short and the gentleman next to him, and I'm then looking for one more comment only. Right, but John first.
John Short, University of Reading. 2 points. One of them more snidey, the other one less so. First, more snidey one is that David Harvey has consistently been, for a geographer, being very insensitive to place. A number of people have argued that he tends to generalise from the North American experience at a particular point in time, really, and from a particular view, the view of a kind of placeless middle class, not even authentic working class North American form. Second point, and much more comradely one taking up his esteem, and this isn't a question as such, it's a general query about the manifesto and how it can implement it, is that it's an attractive proposition. You know, let the people speak, let's create people's geography. And all for that. The problem is, as Neil Smith mentioned, there's more than one voice coming from them out there. And they're contradictory. The experience in the inner city, for example, where the police, for example, in inner London are quite keen to have people's policing. In the sense of white London proletariat backlash against the blacks. And that's a people's policing in certain parts of London. Now that's a snidey comment, that's the kind of problems we're going to come up against when we have a people's geography. And the final remark about Neil Smith's comment is, why should we prioritise the working class? Why prioritise their voice? In the sense, institutionalised voice is male-dominated, production-orientated, a top-down view of social transformation. I'm not all for that. So I'm not all for an untheorized commitment to the working class, whoever they may be.
Gwyn Goddy Sheffield, interests at hopefully seeking the truth. Can I ask a question of David Harvey on the questions which have already been asked? Does he think that he's actually got his message across, or does he think that people have come here with preconceived ideas and have refused to reconsider those ideas?
James Anderson, and just one more comment after that.
James Anderson, Open University. Just three quick points. First of all, think the sort of polemical style almost inevitably meant that the distinction between the analytic tradition and the Marxist one was drawn much too sharply, and I would argue to the detriment of the latter. While you can point to Hopkins and Clue being interested in space and so on, I think the notion that the other side was simply adding a few ad hoc concessions here and there. I mean, would you call Trotsky's theory of combined uneven development, which is actually quite interesting geographically, as simply an ad hoc concession? So I think in setting them up that way, the anarchist tradition versus the Marxist one, I think the whole intellectual weight of the thing is a bit lopsided. And that lopsidedness is skated over by simply counterposing it in the way you do. The second thing is, of course, that that lopsidedness, the weight on the Marxist side, I mean, is just so riddled with different traditions. I mean, it is no longer possible to talk about the Marxist tradition and assume you know what you mean. Do they mean Gramsci, as David Slater was talking about? Do they mean Stalin in Russia? What do they mean? Do they mean Marx himself? Do they mean Engels, etc., etc.? So I think it's very difficult to actually address this question seriously at this sort of level. But I would suggest that you do underplay the Marxist contribution to understanding space and the integration of space within it. I'm not trying to say that it's been done and done adequately, but I think you do underplay it. Maybe that's okay for a political manifesto. I think also, though, you seem to be suggesting rather idealist explanations of political conflicts. I mean, you seem to be suggesting that only if only the theoretical foundations had been got sorted out, if only Marx had been a geographer, you wouldn't have problems over the national question, or uneven development, or socialism in one country. Now, just take socialism in one country, for instance. I mean, do you see that as Marxist? I mean, this you're immediately into central problems of what you mean by Marxism there, and lump these all together makes it very difficult for meaningful discussion. I mean, socialism in one country, I would, from my point of view, is not Marxist, never was, never will be, is an impossibility, and as somebody said, he lived in a country that was labeled socialist. Well, I mean, what are labels? I mean, you know, I can say, well, I'm an anarchist, or I'm a conservative, you know, and what does it mean? Do you necessarily accept people at their face value? What they say they are, why should we do it for countries? And the third point has already been covered, really, and that is the question of connections with powerful or special interests. Okay, you don't want to be beholden and simply do what special interests say. You really confuse two things there. One, you say narrow, and the other hand, you say powerful, right? Narrow or powerful special interests. There's actually a very big difference. I think Neil Smith has already covered the point. But it raises the central question to you, David, that if you're talking about moving towards socialism, what do you mean by it? Because, you know, it is a label. It isn't just one label. It's a multitude of labels, and it's pretty important that you know which direction your label is pointing, because they point in all sorts of different directions.
I take the last comment. Please set a model of brevity, which other people will be advised to follow on future occasions.
Can I just say that my name is Mitchell, University of Reading, that I very much appreciate Professor Harvey's emphasis on the need for a popular and applied geography and the need for an overarching philosophy that we can fit the whole thing into so it can be practical and useful. But what I would like to question very fundamentally, why a materialist explanation needs to be the correct one when we have all these inconsistencies and differences within the materialist philosophy and, in fact, contradiction between the degree of idealism proposed and what materialism leads to. And that's the first part of the question. The second one is, why does he reject perhaps a religious explanation such as Islam or Christianity?
Next impossible task, 5 minutes.
Five minutes to dinner.
5 minutes to pre-dinner drinks, in fact, not dinner.
Oh, well, that's even worse. I'm not sure I'm going to be able to put all of these things together. Let me first start with a comment to Mr. Rowley. Have I achieved what I wanted to do? Yes, I've annoyed everybody, which is... secondly, what do I mean by the people? what I certainly say in the paper and what I thought I was saying when I was standing here, and I may not have said it right, was that there is no such thing as the people, independent of conflict and contradictions. Therefore, people's geography must internalize all of those contradictions and conflicts. That is not a problem for us. That is our terrific, terrific opportunity. That is, instead of constructing the world as seen from outer space or somewhere like that, you construct it in terms of the conflicts. If you have a conflict between the inner city and the suburb or something, you construct the geography in terms of that conflict. And you can represent what the big downtown interests want or what the multinationals want. You can get inside there and represent it. And they have an authentic view of the world. I don't think they're inherently evil. They have a view of the world. They view it through certain windows. They have certain things. And you can represent it. And we represent that. And then you can take from another angle, another window, from the standpoint of other groups. That is, I don't see a people's geography as being homogeneous. I see it as being pluralistic by definition. It has to be. Because it has to be materialistically founded, i.e., founded in the groupings as they exist, in the aspirations of people as you find them. And in that sense, to the degree that there is universal proletarian consciousness, sure, we construct construct understandings from the standpoint of universal working class. I've yet to find very much evidence of the universalism of working class, which gets me back to maybe Jim Anderson's point. Wherever you go and people are talking about the nobility of working class struggles, when you get through to it, it's always the English working class that is thought about, or some abstract kind of quality up there. It's very rare that we find this universal proletarian consciousness or universal proletarian interests even. So what we have to do is to construct a people's geography not in that homogeneous kind of sense, but precisely in that many-angled, many-faceted, many-windowed sense in which we see clearly what the contradictions and conflicts are and try to represent what those conflicts and contradictions are. I think the left makes a very profound mistake by not getting inside what the right is really thinking and trying to understand it properly. The right makes the same kind of mistake. We are in a position, I think, to start to represent geographically a lot of those issues, conflicts between societies, between communities. So that's what I mean by people's geography. Not some homogeneous kind of entity, but one in which the real conflicts are represented. Don't shy away from conflicts and contradictions. They're the stuff that makes history move. They're the things that you can engage in on one side or the other. They're the things that you're involved in. And to me, that is the crux of any intellectual, academic, political, or other involvement, is to try to reconstruct what the other person is thinking in order to better understand how your group can maneuver, your group can move. And when I say that it calls for scientific rigor and scientific honesty, what it says is that you're looking to reconstruct how they think from their perspective. That is, you don't sort of start putting them down and kind of saying they're evil, monstrous people. I mean, they may be evil, monstrous people, and that's not the point. The point is to try to reconstruct exactly what their objectives are and why those objectives are necessary to them. So that a people's geography has to be seen in that kind of way. And I think we have to be prepared to internalize that within our discipline. That is, we're dead scared of that kind of conflict within our own discipline. One of the great things that happened with the radical resurgence of the late 1960s, one of the great things that happened there was precisely that we began to internalize some of this conflict. But one of the most important things is that we should keep talking to each other across that conflict. And one of the things that bothers me a great deal, much about the left as on the right, is the ghettoization of both. That is, we are losing an opportunity to try to learn about these conflictual processes by not developing that common language, which seems to me the intellectual task. Well, how can I talk to somebody who has a radically different viewpoint? How can I find a way to represent what they're saying, which is honest in terms of their own light, but which at the same time serves my purpose. That seems to me to be very much what people's geography is about. That leads me then to consider some of the other points. David Slater's comment was probably more addressed to the limits to capital than it was addressed to the paper. The limits to capital was a limited exercise, as its title indicates. It was a limited exercise in seeing how far you could go with a certain line of analysis. I never said it was the whole truth and nothing but the truth. In fact, I specifically say at the end, this is a limited exercise. It is a beginning. It gets me so far in understanding certain things, and it got me so far in understanding certain things. It is not the whole truth. And I think the same is true about the transition to socialism. Let me make an argument about that. Capitalism has been around, I don't know, depends who you listen to, but it's not been around that long in terms of the timescale of human history. It's a revolutionary force. It's constantly revolutionizing the way in which we live. We don't choose whether we live through revolutions or not. They're going to go on all the time. That is the nature of the capitalist beast. It's not a question of is there or is there not going to be change. There is only the question of what kind of changes are there going to be. And we have to put ourselves on some side of that change. Jim Anderson asked me for a definition of socialism. I'm asked sort of indirectly, well, is it like it is over in Leipzig? The answer to that is, I don't know what socialism is. And if anybody here thinks they knows what socialism is, then it's a bit like a medieval monk sitting in a monastery and saying he knew what capitalism was. It's a crazy idea. And to substantiate the positive aspects, I have no exact idea of what that means. It is a process. It is a process of becoming. And I think that is the strength of what Marx had to say. It's the strength of what many of the radicals had to say in the late 1960s from many different perspectives, humanists and the like. It's a process of becoming. And the process of becoming and engaging in that is looking towards the construction of an alternative kind of society to the one we have. Because the one we have is in a mess. I make very specifically the argument, which I deeply believe and which other people don't seem to be too impressed by, in the limits to capital, that the price of the stabilization of capitalism in the 20th century has been two world wars. And the question that stares me in the face, and it doesn't matter whether I'm working class or anything else, the question that stares me in the face is, am I prepared to go through the stabilization of capitalism a third time by that means? And the answer is, hell no. And that's why I think we're involved in a very, very vital situation of a collective responsibility and concern to think of a process of becoming that does not involve us in the kind of process of becoming that existed in the Second World War, the First World War. We need something a little bit more superior to that. And we have to think that through. And we have to think that through in that context of these tremendous diversity of different political interests. Geographical, geopolitical interests, class interests. That is a tremendous intellectual task. And I would argue that social theorists in general have not really approached that adequately. And what we have to do is to think that through and to really work on that task. Because as far as I'm concerned anyway, yes, a bunch of stuffy bourgeois professors, I'd be very happy to live out a stuffy bourgeois life on a high salary in Johns Hopkins University. I'd have a great time. I'm having a great time. I wouldn't want to be a Marxist. I wouldn't want to be a Marxist and get upset about things, but I am upset about what it seems to me, the trajectory of the development of capitalism. Where it's going, where it's taking us. And if it's taking us into World War III, maybe that's an American bias. Maybe I've been around Ronnie Reagan too much, you know. But when he says, you know, a limited interchange of nuclear missiles over Europe would be one possibility, I think to myself, hell yes, they could have another Marshall Plan and start all over again afterwards. And if that's what you want, then okay, I mean, that's a possible path, and take it seriously, it really is a possible path. And we have to think out the alternatives, and we have to think them out, not sort of idealistically in terms of some project of you, but in terms of trying to work with interest towards something that I don't know what it is. It's the alternative to capitalism. Call it socialism, communism, whatever you like. It's an alternative to the capitalist mode of production. I don't know exactly what it is, but we have to find it, we have to search for it, and we have to search for it through genuine political means.
Okay. I must thank both the contributors who got a short experience of what it must be like to appear on Question Time and sound coherent, and also, most of all, on behalf of the department, to David Harvey for his lecture to us. And I guess that the best vote of thanks that he could get is not some kind of formal statement from me, but if all of us were to take his words with us out of this lecture theatre and reflect on them for 5 minutes every morning for the next year. Thank you, David.
All right, thank you.